Welcome to Cambridge Forum, discussing Obama and Iran, a single roll of the dice with the book's author, Trita Parsi. I'm Aaron Schachter, senior editor for the Public Radio International program, The World, and I will be your moderator today. As the threat of hostilities hangs over the Middle East again, what should the United States policy toward Iran be? Our speaker, Trita Parsi, explores this question in his new book, A Single Roll of the Dice, Obama's Diplomacy with Iran. To write the book, Trita interviewed 70 high-ranking officials from the US, Iran, Europe, Israel, Saudi Arabia, Turkey, and Brazil, including the top American and Iranian negotiators. From this kaleidoscope of information, Parsi assembles all the pieces of the complex and often misunderstood details of the administration's effort to end three decades of futility with Iran. Have US diplomatic approaches to Iran under Obama worked? Was the Bush administration's approach, relying heavily on the threat of military intervention, a better one? And what is the best way to move forward toward a positive relationship with Iran? Have no fear. All those questions are answered in this book. Trita Parsi is the founder and president of the National Iranian American Council and an expert on U.S.-Iranian relations, Iranian foreign policy, and the geopolitics of the Middle East. He's the author of the award-winning book, Treacherous Alliance, The Secret Dealings of Iran, Israel, and the United States. His articles on Middle East affairs have been published in a wide array of journals, especially recently, including the Wall Street Journal, New York Times, Financial Times, Jane's Intelligence Review, The Nation, The American Conservative, and The Jerusalem Post, among others. And he is a frequent guest on CNN, the PBS NewsHour, NPR, the BBC, The World, and Al Jazeera. Welcome to Cambridge Forum, Trita Parsi.
Thank you so much. It's a great pleasure being here. Thank you, Aaron. Thank you, Pam, for this kind invitation and for all of you to come here today. I'm really pleased to see this crowd. I'm pleased to see that there's an energy and a lot of hope. Let me just at the outset warn you about one thing. The topic that I'm about to speak to you about is not a particularly uplifting one. It is frankly quite depressing. If you are already suffering from depression, I advise you to leave now. I won't be offended, because I don't want to be responsible for pushing you over the edge. But hopefully there will be a slimmer of hope at the end of this talk. As was said in the introduction, the book is about the Obama administration's Iran policy, what actually has happened, where did it go wrong? What did it succeed? What did it accomplish? What were the calculations of all the different sides in this drama? And I rely quite heavily both on official documents, as well as a lot of the stuff that came out through the WikiLeaks and other documents that some government officials handed over to me, and interviews. And I go to great lengths to try to interview people from all the sides involved, which, as was mentioned, includes everything from the Israelis, Saudis, to Obama administration officials, but also the Iranian negotiators, just to make sure we get a 360-degree picture of what it is that actually has happened. How come we are in this rather dire situation right now, 3 years into Obama's presidency? So let me start off with a quote from President Obama himself. To the Muslim world, we seek a new way forward, based on mutual interest and mutual respect. To those who cling to power through corruption and deceit and the silencing of dissent, know that you are on the wrong side of history, but that we will extend a hand if you are willing to unclench your fist. Only 12 and a half minutes into Obama's presidency, he reaches out to the Iranians in his inaugural address and offers a hand of friendship if they would unclench their fists. It was a bold move, but it was not born out of desire as much as it was born out of necessity. As some would argue that the Bush administration pursued wars of choice, in the case of Iran and Obama, I think he was pursuing what he saw as a piece of necessity. It's important to keep in mind the backdrop of all of this. The Bush administration pursued an ideological foreign policy in which one of its tenets said that you do not talk to your enemies, because if you do, you will strengthen them and you will risk legitimizing them. As a result, diplomacy is set aside only for those states that deserve America's company. Now, one can have whatever views one wish to have about that ideology, but I think its track record, particularly in the case of Iran, is quite clear. When Bush came into office, the Iranians had something less than 50 centrifuges. By the time he left office in 2008, Iran had more than 8,000 centrifuges. Iran was squeezed between two hostile regimes, the Taliban to its east, Saddam Hussein to its west. By the time Bush left office, Iran had become the kingmaker of the political order in those two countries. Its soft power in the region was on the rise because it was cleverly taking advantage of popular frustration and an increasingly unpopular America in the region. Against this backdrop, Obama did something that few before him had dared to do. He actually made the case that diplomacy should be a cornerstone of American foreign policy, and that the U.S. should negotiate with its enemies. And negotiations with Iran quickly became the poster child of that platform. Now, what under normal circumstances would have been political suicide, in the case of Obama in 2008, it essentially became a winning card, precisely because of the American population's general rejection of the Bush administration's foreign policy and its underlying philosophy and ideology. Now, the administration knew that time was short. In its own estimation, this unprecedented window for diplomacy would only last about 12 months. And it would only last that long because of several different factors. One, the Iranians were continuing to enrich uranium, and they would soon have enough uranium for one nuclear bomb, around 1,000 to 1,200 kilos. Once they got that, the pressure for the United States to take military action, they predicted, would increase significantly. So it was important to get a solution prior to that. Then there was a lot of pressure from states that were friends of the United States but were very worried that in a negotiation, the United States would strike a deal that would jeopardize their security interests. And those two states in particular were Israel and Saudi Arabia, that from the very outset adopted a very negative view of Obama's outreach to Iran. There was also some concern among some of the Europeans who were involved in this, particularly in France. The French president felt that Obama may be so eager to get a nuclear deal that he would sacrifice some of the long-standing principles and red lines of the West. And then, of course, there was the constant drumbeat that the Israelis may take military action on their own. Of all of America's close friends, many wished Obama well, but very few actually wished him success. And this was quite recurring throughout these 3 years. Now, once in office, the first 4 months of the administration's time was spent on actually figuring out what the policy should be and what the strategy should be. By the time they had figured that out, by mid-April, 4 months has already passed, and now the next question that they were faced with was, when should we begin this diplomacy? The Iranians are having an election in June of that year. Can the Iranians negotiate in the midst of their own political season? And if they can, would negotiations with Iran under those circumstances potentially actually help Ahmadinejad get reelected? Something that obviously President Obama would not want to be credited for. A decision was made not to start any negotiations until after the elections in Iran, with the hope and expectation that by June 13th, the day after the elections, there would be some clarity, there would be a loser, or several losers, and there would be one winner, and soon thereafter negotiations could begin. That's of course not the way that it happened, because instead you had massive fraud in the elections, massive human rights abuses that played out in front of everyone to see, because of every person in Iran with an iPhone or a telephone had become an eye reporter and could put up the videos of how the government in Iran brutally repressed its own population on YouTube, which then quickly was caught up by CNN and others. I know there's a debate as to whether there really was fraud or not. I'm not going to go into that debate because I haven't been able to find any way to see any utility in reaching a conclusion on that. But let me just give you a couple of examples that to me is convincing that at least something was wrong with those elections. On the morning of the election day, one of Mousavi's headquarters — Mousavi was the reformist or the centrist reformist candidate challenging Ahmadinejad — his headquarters was attacked by a dozen security officers who went in there on the pretext that there was a TV studio inside the headquarters that did not have a license. There was no such TV studio. It was just a bunch of kids who were using computer software to produce videos, campaign videos that they put on YouTube. The volunteers at Mousavi's office, however, wrestled down the security officers, tied them down, and locked them up in the basement of the building. They called the head of the security, or the head of the judiciary in Iran, and asked them what to do. He told them, you should call the police, they'll handle the situation. The police arrives, they take out these dozen or so security officers, hand them over to the police. The police releases them on the spot outside, and they disappear into the crowds. 2 hours later, they're back with reinforcement. They sack the headquarters, and they arrest the first and second circle of advisors around Mousavi. Same thing happened to Karoubi. The arrest warrants for these individuals had been issued 4 days before the elections. Then in the evening, before the polls have closed, there's an announcement on TV that lo and behold, Ahmadinejad has won 62.5% of the vote. Shocking everyone, including the TV anchors that were told to announce this. Now, I'm not saying that the Iranians are as incompetent as those in Florida when it comes to vote counting. But counting 40 million handwritten votes in a couple of hours, in fact, before all the votes have been cast, that's a degree of efficiency that the Iranian government rarely exhibits on other issues. So I think there's some legitimate question marks about what actually happened there. Now, what this did for the Obama administration was that, on the one hand, this further created a problem for them because 6 months of their 12-month window had already passed. Now there was even more political instability in Iran. I mean, the political elite was essentially at war with itself and with the population. It was complete paralysis. They could not conduct any negotiations. And it wasn't clear at what point they could be. When would the dust settle, as the president said, in addressing when those type of negotiations could begin. And then there was a second problem. This massive human rights abuse that took place in Iran really dealt a big blow to the administration's moral comfort with the idea of negotiations. It was one thing to argue about negotiations in the abstract, theoretically. But once you were actually faced with the situation of talking to this government while it was engaged in such human rights abuses, it created a different level of uncomfort for them. But something had happened only 10 days before the elections that nevertheless convinced the administration that there was a significant reason, or at least some plausibility, that negotiations could succeed and should be pursued. That was that on June 2nd, 2009, the Iranians sent a letter to El-Baradei, the head of the IAEA, the International Atomic Energy Agency, saying that their reactor, their Tehran research reactor, had run out of fuel, and they wanted to buy fuel pads. El-Baradei realized that this is an opportunity, and instead of doing what he should have done according to protocol and inform all potential sellers, he only informs the United States and Russia, knowing very well that the administration had been thinking about ideas, how can we convince the Iranians to get their low-enriched uranium out of the country so they don't have that breakout capability because their stockpile would be reduced? And what do they need to offer in order to convince the Iranians to give up their strategic asset? Now, there was an opportunity that came out of nowhere because the fuel pads that you need to charge up these reactors are built on low-enriched uranium. So the idea came up that instead of selling this to the Iranians, let's offer them to take their own low-enriched uranium, turn it into fuel pads, and give the fuel pads back to them once the process is over with. That way, the Iranians get the fuel pads that they want, and the West manages to reduce Iran's low LEU stockpile and add more time to the nuclear clock. The question was, when could the offer be made? The Russians and the United States, in the context of the reset between those relations, came up with the idea, worked out the details, and then the question was, when do we take this to the Iranians? By August, it had become clear to the administration that 8 months of their 12 months had now passed. There was no indication of when there would be political stability in Iran. And if they didn't try to negotiate, perhaps the entire 12-month window would close, and they would never have known whether it could or could not have succeeded. So by September, they signaled the Iranians that they want negotiations. The Iranians accept on October 1st, for the first time, the United States, the P5 plus one states, and Iran sit down and they talk. And for the first time, the U.S. is an active participant in these negotiations. Prior to that, the U.S. was always absent, and in one occasion, Undersecretary of State Bill Burns was permitted to attend the meeting with the strict instructions that he's not permitted to talk. Now, however, the U.S. was a full participant. The proposal is made to the Iranians that there would be a fuel swap. The Iranians agree in principle, and they agree to have a meeting at the technical level within 3 weeks to hash out the details. The rest of the afternoon of October 1st is spent on negotiating a half-page press release that only discussed what had actually happened in the meeting. That's what most of diplomacy actually is about. October 19th, they meet in Vienna, and at this moment, this is where the actual details of the proposal is really presented to the Iranians. And the details are such. Out of Iran's 1,500 kilos of LEU, 1,200 would be shipped out, sent to Russia. The Russians would re-enrich it to 20%, send it to France. The French would turn it into fuel pads. And about a year later, the Iranians would get their fuel pads for their reactors. It's at this point that the Iranians start to object. Their first objection is, who invited the French to the party? They had very bad history of negative relations with the French on the nuclear field. And they did not see why the French would be a party of this, while the U.S. is actually not playing any role in this fuel swap. Why couldn't the U.S. actually produce the fuel swap, fuel pads instead of the French? They fail at pushing out the French from the deal, but their second objection is a little bit more understandable. They make the argument that this way that the swap was structured would put most of the risk on the shoulders of Iran. It would take a year before the Iranians would get their fuel pads. And under those 12 months, what is the guarantee that the West would not renege on the deal? They already have Iran's stockpile. How would the Iranians feel secure that, mindful of the fact that they mistrust the West just as much as the West mistrusts Iran, that they would not essentially be taken for granted on this? They make the proposal of only of dividing the swap into three shipments, each shipment 400 kilos, and every time they give LEU, the West would give it fuel pads. That way, they argued, the risk would be more evenly distributed. This was not acceptable to the U.S., though, for two reasons. One, these fuel pads are not readily available. It takes about 6 to 8 months to produce them. And there's only one reactor of this kind, so there's no stockpile of fuel pads. And secondly, for political reasons, the entire purpose of the swap was to get the Iranian LEU stockpile well below 1,200 kilos. If you have 1,500 and you take out 400, you're still too close to the neighborhood. So as a result, it wouldn't add time to the clock in the manner that the administration wanted. By the third day, it's quite clear the two sides are not going to be able to reach a compromise. El-Baradei encourages them to either go out and admit that the talks have been a failure, or to say that we're going to take the proposals back to our capitals and after 3 days come with a final answer. They agreed to do the latter. Immediately, the United States, Russia, and France send in their approval of the proposal in writing, which wasn't too difficult. They approved their own proposal. The Iranians, however, do not come with a yes nor with a no. It's asking for more time, it's asking for another technical meeting, asking for further guarantees that the United States and the West would actually hold up their end of the bargain. By mid-November, it's clear. This diplomatic effort had not reached the results that they had hoped for. There had been some efforts to try to salvage it, it didn't work. By end of November, the president activates the pressure track. And instead of pursuing diplomacy, we were now going to pursue sanctions at the UN Security Council. Expectation was that by February 2010, crippling sanctions would be able to be imposed on the Iranians at the Security Council to punish them for not having agreed to the fuel swap, while also restoring the administration's own political status by saying that, yes, we tried diplomacy, it didn't succeed, but look at the type of sanctions that we managed to get in place on the Iranians as a result of that. But it didn't work out that way, because February passes, March passes, April passes. There's too much resistance from the Russians and the Chinese. They don't agree that diplomacy has been exhausted. They're asking for all types of concessions from the United States to agree to the sanctions. And there starts to be a sense of panic in the administration because Congress is pushing for their own sanctions. And the United States is trying to make sure that it gets UN sanctions before Congress comes in and goes in with their own sanctions. And at that moment, two states emerge almost out of nowhere and decide that they're going to try to resolve this issue using their own diplomatic acumen. Turkey and Brazil. Two states that were both non-permanent members of the Security Council at the time, who all had their own interest in being involved in this issue for various reasons, including the way their economies would be affected by a potential war, and who also had a sense that as rising powers, they had something to prove, that they actually could play a role on the international field. On May 16th, 2010, President Lula of Brazil arrives in Tehran. A day later, Erdogan of Turkey joins him, and they begin 18-hour marathon negotiations to try to get the Iranians to agree to the deal based on the American benchmarks, 1,200 kilos, etc. Very tough negotiations, quite tense at times, but at the end of the talks, they have managed to get the Iranians to say yes and put their signature on an agreement. The Turks and the Brazilians are ecstatic. They have managed to do something that the Europeans and others before them had failed to do for several years. The second person that Celso Amorim, the Brazilian foreign minister, calls after finishing the negotiations is Secretary Hillary Clinton. He shares with her the details of the deal. The Iranians would give up 1,200 kilos of LEU, put it in an escrow in Turkey, and then a year later they would get their fuel pads. If the fuel pads didn't arrive, the Iranians could go and get their LEU back from Turkey. That was the guarantee, the mechanism of trust to make sure that they would say yes. It had actually been endorsed by Obama during a meeting between him, Lula, and Erdogan on April 13th in Washington. But to Amorim's great surprise, Secretary Clinton declares that the deal is absolutely unacceptable. What Turkey and Brazil did not know was that 2 days before they had arrived in Tehran, Russia and China had finally come to an agreement on a new sanctions draft. And between UN Security Council sanctions and a nuclear breakthrough based on the benchmarks of the American proposal from 6 months earlier, the administration chose the sanctions. Secretary Clinton goes to the Senate 2 days later, announces that a new sanctions draft has been approved, that it will be circulated that afternoon, and then adds, "This is our clearest answer we can give to the developments of this past weekend," referring to the negotiations. Now, the administration had a case, because facts on the ground had changed. Iran had now 2,400 kilos of LEU. You take 1,200 out, they still got 1,200. They had started 20% enrichment, higher level of enrichment, which they did not have in October 2009, and the deal doesn't address that. And it got really tense between Brazil and Turkey and the United States, because they felt that they had done exactly what the US had asked them to do. So tense that a week or two later, someone in Lula's office in Brazil releases to the Brazilian media a letter from President Obama, dated April 20th, 3 weeks before Lula goes to Tehran, in which the president says that it would be a significant value to American security if Brazil could convince the Iranians to take 1,200 kilos out of their LEU, put it in an escrow in Turkey, and convinced them to accept that the fuel pads would not be given back until exactly 12 months later. Exactly what the Turks and the Brazilians actually did. In fact, they followed that letter from the president in order in the negotiations to make sure that they delivered everything that was in the letter from the president. So why did then President Obama, who did reach out and hand to the Iranians, at the time when he did manage to get a deal, go for sanctions instead? The arguments about the different LEU counts are valid, but they're not central. In fact, they're not decisive. The real reason was that the administration had completely run out of political space. Congress was coming at it as a steamroller, and if the US did not go along with the sanctions in the Security Council, then Congress would have gone forward with their own sanctions. And those sanctions would have targeted Russia and China. And there would have been a conflict within the P5 states. And that would then enable the Iranians to take advantage of the differences within the Security Council, precisely because the administration either felt that it couldn't or didn't want to take on Congress and tell them, we got a deal, don't pass any sanctions. And what it shows is that so many times, solutions actually have been found. Diplomacy actually has worked. But the timing has been such that the domestic politics in either Iran or in the United States has disabled either side from being able to say yes, at times even to their own deal. The title of the book is called A Single Roll of the Dice. It's actually a quote from one of Obama's own officials who told me that by the time we managed to get everyone to the table, so much of the political capital and maneuverability of the administration had been lost, so that the policy became a gamble on a single roll of the dice. It had to work right away or not at all. And there's rarely any situation in which diplomacy works in that type of instantaneous, fast food way. Every time that diplomacy has worked, it's worked precisely because it did have the political backing, it had the political will and capital behind it. In fact, if we continue to have a political landscape in Iran and in the United States in which the leaders of those states feel that it actually is politically less risky, less costly to send off thousands of servicemen and women off to a war and a certain death than it is for that same leader to take a political risk by sending off a few dozen diplomats to negotiate. If that political landscape remains, then we will have far more clenched fists than open hands between these two countries to come. Thank you so much. I'll stop.
Because the administration decides at the time that we're not equals. We are the United States up here, and you are Iran down there. As someone who's worked in the halls of power in the United Nations, how do decisions like this get made? You know, in the schoolyard, it's hard to, you need to deal with each other as equals. In Congress, you need to deal with each other as equals. I'm sorry to go backwards, but the reason I'm asking the question is you can look back from the Obama administration and see what happened in 2002 and think, aha, as you say in the book, mutual respect is what they want. Let's try that for a while. And I know you say they for 12 months there was an attempt. But if that is ultimately what Iran is after, and you know that they're willing to make a deal, how do we get from there, 2002, to here?
I think it's a great question. I think the Obama administration needs to get credit because they actually went to great lengths to try to change the atmospherics. In 2009, they really changed the language in the way that the two countries dealt with each other. The language, the very aggressive ideological language of the Bush administration was... Axis of Evil was completely eradicated. And to give an example, candidate Obama on several occasions said that he would negotiate with the Iranians using carrots and sticks, which is a metaphor in the United States that doesn't have a negative connotation. It just means positive and negative incentives. It doesn't translate that well into Persian. Both culturally and linguistically, it really sounds bad. It essentially sounds that Iran is a donkey, and we're going to either trick it or punish it into submission. By the time Obama came into office and this was brought to his attention, within 2 weeks, this talking point was eradicated. Until this day, I've not seen a single Obama administration official using the terminology carrots and sticks. And I think it goes to show that there was an attempt. It was an attempt that was flawed. It was too limited. But there was a desire to be able to change this. But we have to understand the context, and that's why I start off in 2003. I call this enmity not an ordinary enmity, but an institutionalized enmity. There are plenty of people on all sides, and plenty of people in other countries that have made careers out of figuring out new ways of being nasty to each other. You don't make a career in the bureaucracy by taking a dovish line, not in the United States, not in Iran. If you want job security in your government, then you're better off being a hawk. So this is self-perpetuating. And that then makes it so difficult to change even the smallest things, such as showing respect. It makes it politically risky. The Iranians till this day complain and saying that Obama was never really genuine because even though he changed the language, he never really lifted any of the sanctions. I think it's an exaggerated expectation on their end. And it's also something that shows we never appreciate, neither side appreciates the political cost that it takes for the other side to change the smallest thing.
Even though the costs are the same.
Even though the costs are the same. We don't recognize that. We don't recognize what it takes for the Iranians to, for instance, send the proposal from 2003. The Iranians don't recognize that just changing the language in the manner that Obama did, taping a Nowruz message, actually does cost him something politically. Now, I'm of the opinion that both sides need to grow up and really accept far greater costs than what they have. But it's sad to see that their expectation of the other is so great and their non-recognition of the risk that the other side is taking is so limited.
This is the big question, and I assume someone will ask this in a moment, but given that, can we move forward?
Well, we have to at the end of the day, and I think what has happened, if you take a look at what's happening just in the last couple of weeks, both the Iranians and the Obama administration are again shifting back towards diplomacy. I think both of them went to the edge of the abyss, they looked down, they realized they don't want to go there, and now they have a mutual interest of seeing how they can walk a few steps back from the edge. Whether they'll succeed or not remains. But people in this room are not innocent bystanders to this. The political landscape that the Obama administration is looking at when it's making its decision of what it can and cannot do, you are that political landscape. If you call for war, if we have this current debate that is so hysterical, that is only looking at bad options, then that creates a political landscape that is skewed towards a confrontation.
I'd like to remind those listening on the radio, you're joining Cambridge Forum as we continue our discussion with Trita Parsi on Obama and Iran, a single roll of the dice. How successful has U.S. diplomacy toward Iran been under Obama? And we will now take some questions. We need you please to go up to the microphone, sir, that's right next to you. Remember, line up on the microphone. We'd like questions, not treatises, if you wouldn't mind. And why don't we try a little mutual respect here as well.
A number of American officials who have dealt with Iran have come up with the idea that an outside third party individual might be able to break this deadlock. Do you have any opinion on this as to how this might work and who it might be?
Thank you. I think that is a very good question, and I would tend to agree that mindful of how difficult it is for the two sides. For instance, right now, there is still a decision on the US side, and I believe the Iranians have the same decision, in which no US diplomat is permitted to speak to an Iranian diplomat without prior authorization from Foggy Bottom. Whereas in all other cases, diplomats constantly talk to each other, they exchange messages, and they report back without getting prior authorization. That's what I mean when I say institutionalized enmity. We've always kind of made it illegal not to be enemies. Under those circumstances, and when trust is so depleted, it is important to see if there can be a third party that can come in, infuse a little bit of a confidence, someone that is not as mistrusted by either side of this. But there's very few candidates, and the few candidates that have tried, like Turkey and Brazil did, were punished, essentially, for having succeeded. And that's one of the sad consequences of what happened to Turkey and Brazil, because it ended up making it even more unlikely that other states would dare to step up in the future. I was in Europe a couple of months ago, and this is right before the Europeans imposed their oil embargo. And it was very interesting seeing the conversation, particularly amongst the non-EU three European states, how they were worried that this is starting to look like Iraq. This is starting to be sanctions for the sake of sanctions, and before we know it, we're deep into a military confrontation. And you could see that they're asking themselves, is there something we can do? But the one thing that kept coming back to their minds is, if you're not accepted, if your mediation is not welcomed, if you don't have guarantee, then you may end up paying a very heavy price, as Turkey and Brazil did, for nothing. The political upside of it is just too small. And that's a very dangerous, very, very dangerous incentive structure to have in place, particularly when it is so difficult for the two sides to resolve their issues on their own.
Could you examine what you've been talking about through a prism of a chess match that's being played here in world politics, that Iran, the Ayatollah Khamenei, not Ahmadinejad, who's simply a spokesperson, with all the threats and all the challenges, are simply playing a chess game at which they're winning and at which the United States will soon be in checkmate. Iran knows that their oil resources are finite and that ultimately they're going to need nuclear power to run their country. That's why they want nuclear power. The game of fear about attacking and wiping out Israel and those factors that we're worrying about are just part of the chess game. But they've succeeded in getting oil prices up, and if the United States or Israel were to strike Iranian nuclear capability, which is components under 250 feet of granite, which even a 30,000 ton bomb can't penetrate, then the price of oil would only go up again. So checkmate United States, checkmate Israel. You can't attack us because you'll drive your economies into the ground. We can't afford a war anywhere, and we're pulling out of Afghanistan as we speak here. And so the question is, would you examine it from a standpoint of a chess match? Where do we stand in this game?
Thank you. I wouldn't go as far as you would in giving either side so much credit to describing them as clever chess players. This has been a negative sum game. Both sides have been losing. There's no winners in this. Even when the Europeans impose, I mean, the idea that you're imposing an oil embargo that would do away with 600,000 barrels of oil that particularly the poorer southern countries of Europe are importing in the midst of their already financial crisis doesn't sound to me like a very clever chess player. Nor is it particularly clever what the Iranians are doing. Iran currently, under the current regime, particularly right now, has essentially negative relations with almost all of its neighbors. I'm not really sure how you can call that winning unless you're Charlie Sheen. So both sides are involved in this negative dynamic, and their self-inflicting wounds are starting to create a lot of problems for the entire world. But I would say one thing that I think you're right about. This entire idea that we can go to war, that you know we can impose all of these different crippling sanctions without the other side being able to inflict a tremendous amount of damage on us, that's completely ludicrous. I mean, that is completely false. The Iranians have, through a few statements and through threats and warnings, managed to help push oil prices above $120 a barrel. According to Vitol, Iran is making more oil than it was before, even though it's selling less because of some of these sanctions and the fact that the U.S. has managed to convince some countries to stop buying oil. And that's just the beginning of it. We're not talking about going all the way that they potentially could in closing the Strait of Hormuz. And there's several steps in between there as well. There could be more statements. There could be more threats. There could be an accident in the Persian Gulf. One Iranian oil tanker may blow up in the Persian Gulf. It's not an attack against another country. It can look like an accident, but everyone knows it's not. It's still going to take 2 weeks to clean it up. It's still going to create a lot of instability in the oil markets. Then, of course, the Republican candidates are doing their utmost to help. All of the statements that they're making is also helping drive oil prices up. The Israelis are playing their part. And at the end of it, the biggest loser in the short term is actually President Obama. Because the higher the oil prices go up, the higher the gas prices go up, and the more difficult it will be for him to create jobs in the United States, which will be a decisive factor for his re-election. This is a game in which both sides can really damage the other. And
the perception is that in the long term, Iran gets the bomb and they win. I think, is that what you're referring to? Ultimately, Iran wins because they get the bomb, regardless of what happens in the interim.
Well, I would say on that, it's because we're accepting this false frame. There's a false frame that is perpetuated in the media right now, not by you, but others, that say that we have to choose between accepting an Iranian bomb or bombing Iran. That's utterly false. There are plenty of other options. There's plenty of more time to actually deal with these issues. The only reason we're staring ourselves blind on these two really bad options is because of the level of hysteria in the discourse. Precisely because this is a serious issue with serious consequences, we need to bring down the level of the discourse, actually bring it up to a level of greater rationality and sanity. So I would really caution against these inevitable, deterministic arguments that eventually Iranians will get it anyways. The U.S. intelligence currently says that Iran does not have an active weapons program. It also says that they have not made a decision to build the bomb. The question then we have to ask ourselves, what can we do to make sure that that decision is not made? What can we do to make sure that whatever the debate is within Iran, it is permanently shifted in the direction that they will choose not to build it? Is making threats of invasion and bombing convincing a country not to go for a nuclear deterrence? I doubt it. But we're not asking ourselves what would cause a country to desire this. And if they haven't made a decision yet, what can we do to make sure they don't?
You spoke about the narrowing of the political options within the United States for negotiations. And I think those of us who've been following this issue at any level understand that the desires of Israel and its supporters in the United States, particularly in the Congress, have played a very central role to that political equation. That's the bad news, I think. The good news is that it's very much out in the open, much more so than on this issue than ever before in terms of our Middle Eastern policy. So my question is, have you noticed in discussions with policymakers and political figures that there is a realization that this is really problematic in the United States, even if they're not able to speak about it publicly? Is there a sense that there has to be pushback against this, what I would call distortion in our sort of political equation with regard to the Middle East?
This is an issue that right now is very much out in the open. This is not a conspiracy or anything like that. It's quite clear. Certain countries are worried about what diplomacy could lead to. They're worried they have the... In fact, in the last 2 weeks, we have seen this play out in a very public way. Because Prime Minister Netanyahu came to the United States after first visiting Canada, and his objective was very clear. On the Iranian issue, he wanted Obama to adopt the Israeli red line on the nuclear issue, which is that Iran cannot have a nuclear capability. The American red line, which had not been very publicly expressed, but nevertheless was a long-standing one, was that Iran cannot build nuclear weapons. Iran cannot have nuclear weapons, meaning that the red line is a very different place. Nuclear capability is a very ambiguous term. It's not really clear what is meant, but largely it's believed to mean that the Iranians cannot have enrichment or have the knowledge of enrichment. Nuclear weapons is a much more clear and tangible red line, a trigger that is much clearer and it's much further down the road. Obama did not yield on this central point. In fact, he did not yield on anything on Iran of any central value during Netanyahu's visit. During his speech at AIPAC, which I think took a lot of people by surprise, he did not even mention nuclear capability. In fact, he made it clear that the red line is nuclear weapons. Then he also made it clear that all of this irresponsible warmongering is only increasing oil prices, which is benefiting the Iranian government. Then he also made it clear that ultimately, in order to be able to resolve this issue, you have to find a way to convince a country that it does not want, that it does not need nuclear weapons. That's a long-term solution. Any approach of military action can at best increase 2 years on the clock before they get it, but it does have the effect of increasing the likelihood that they will get it down the road. So on that central issue, Obama has not yielded at all, and I think it took a lot of people by surprise, and a lot of people were actually impressed. But the battle has not ended, because what Netanyahu could not get in his face-to-face meeting with Obama, Congress is now trying to impose on Obama, particularly some lawmakers such as McCain, Lieberman, Casey from Pennsylvania are trying to pass legislation that again makes nuclear capability the red line. And part of the reason why the U.S. military is so opposed to that as a red line is because it essentially means in order for Iran not to have a nuclear capability, you have to bomb all of the Iranian facilities, you have to kill all of the Iranian scientists, and then you have to burn all physics books. Otherwise, you can still make the argument that they have the capability. This is not the type of a red line that the US military would accept. In fact, they view it as a fast track towards war, which I would tend to agree with.
Short question, because it's a long, long line. Where do we go from here with respect to Iran, United States, and Israel? Because a war is looming, because Israel regards Iran as an existential threat for all kinds of obvious reasons. Seems to me the existential threat could be reduced if Ahmadinejad would simply stop talking the way he does in this threatening way. I think that could go a long way. And that's just a matter of changing your speech and stop appearing as an existential threat, aside from the realities of a nuclear bomb.
Thank you. I would tend to agree with you on the latter part of your question, that the rhetoric coming out of Ahmadinejad and a few other Iranian officials has also quite clearly contributed to this atmosphere of hysteria. In fact, all of the radicals on all sides are feeding off of each other in this. And this is extremely unhelpful. It's further making it difficult to be able to find the political space for a solution. But on the issue that Israel views Iran as an existential threat, I think the issue is actually quite a lot more complicated. It is a very commonly used talking point by Israeli officials. It is something that after 10 years of repeating it, and of course the Iranians helping by making very problematic and aggressive statements, has convinced a lot of ordinary Israelis among the Israeli public to believe this. But when you sit down with Israeli officials, I came back from Israel just 2 months ago, it's a quite different picture. People at the top that are making these decisions do not believe it to be an existential threat. They see a political utility in making the argument, but their concerns are primarily that if Iran were to get a nuclear capability, be an accepted nuclear state, it would be sufficient, even if they don't build a bomb, it would be sufficient to shift the balance of power in the region in such a way that Israel's maneuverability in the region would be far more limited than it is right now. Invasions or incursions into Gaza, Lebanon, etc., would those things be possible in a different Middle East where the Arab side, so to say, has a superpower backer? Moreover, the fear that if there is an international acceptance by the Iranians having enrichment and having an enrichment program, that would mean that the U.S. would make a deal with Iran. There wouldn't be a love affair, but U.S.-Iran tensions would decrease. But would there be a proportional reduction in Israeli-Iranian tensions? Most likely there wouldn't. And this kicks in the Israeli fear of abandonment, that they would be in a situation in which even though the U.S. then reduces its problems with Iran, Israel's problem with Iran remains pretty much the same, and Israel will have a greater difficulty getting support from the United States to confront Iran. And this has then caused the Israelis for quite some time, this is not a Netanyahu thing, to oppose diplomacy, fearing that the solution actually would be worse than a military confrontation from their perspective. And I tend to disagree with the way that they define their national interest in this issue. If you read some of the WikiLeaks, some of them are quite entertaining. There was a meeting between Undersecretary of State for Nonproliferation, Tosher, with Amos Gilad, who used to be, I think at the time, was the head of military intelligence. And Amos Gilad makes it very clear in those conversations, we have no problem with diplomacy as long as you know that it will fail.
It's a complicated answer, but I'll give up the mic because there's people behind me.
Just a quick question, actually. What would you suggest we can do as ordinary citizens here? And the kind of rhetoric that's coming out is like a Hollywood film that we've seen before. So the weapons of mass destruction in Iraq, there was none. I personally don't believe even that the nuclear being an issue, because there's a country right next to Iran, bordering Iran, Pakistan, with stockpile of nuclear weapons. I don't hear anything on the news, CNN, Fox, nobody discusses it. The whole country can go very quickly into the hands of the Taliban or pro-Taliban or Al-Qaeda. And if there's one country that the US should really invade and think about bombing, or Israel should, it should be Pakistan. And it's not even discussed. It's not brought up. It's not an issue. Just forget about it. Pakistan doesn't have oil, doesn't have gas. I mean, that's another problem too. So we've seen this film before. We saw it with Iraq. You know, 65% of Americans thought that Saddam has something to do with 9/11. Unfortunately, the last statistic that I saw, consensus, was that more than 50% think that Iran is a threat to the US. I mean, I read somewhere that Iranian nuclear capability, the biggest threat of that is to Iran itself, because it can blow up any minute. It's, you know, with sanctions, with poor components that they purchase from everywhere, what they produce themselves, the wiring, that thing can blow up any minute. And it can kill all the scientists and all the technicians inside. So this is a non-issue. What can we do to stop that film, Hollywood film, repeating itself? Thank you.
Very good question. Thank you. You forgot the number one rule of international relations. You don't invade a country that already has nuclear weapons. Just don't. And you stop complaining about it as well. I think your question is very important because it talks about what you all in the audience can do. I think it's important to keep in mind that diplomacy has not been failed. It essentially was abandoned because of a lack of political space. Let's remind ourselves what type of diplomacy has worked in the past. In the past, when the US has negotiated and has succeeded, it has usually at minimum taken about 4 years for those negotiations to succeed. It took 4 years for the US and Vietnam to normalize relations between 1990 and 1994 over the course of two presidencies. Another 6 years for the two countries to have a full trade agreement. It took exactly 7 years for the United States to convince Libya to give up and capitulate its nuclear program over the course of two presidencies again. For some period of that 7 years, talks broke down and were on freeze, essentially, because of various political reasons. There's a wonderful quote from Senator Mitchell, who mediated the Good Friday Agreement between Northern Ireland, the fighting parties in Northern Ireland. He said this on Charlie Rose. He said something along the lines that for the first 700 days, both sides told me they would never agree to anything the other side would agree to. On the 700th first day, they both changed their minds. Fortunately for us, fortunately for the people of Northern Ireland, Senator Mitchell did not give up during those first 700 days. He kept at it. He gave diplomacy the same commitment that we believe we have to give to war, in the sense that we don't back out of that. We give deadlines for diplomacy. I've never heard anyone, even before a war, saying that we should have a deadline for war. We don't even have a deadline for our sanctions. But when it comes to diplomacy, we say that we don't want to come across as weak, but there's nothing that comes across as weak more than the fear of talking. A superpower in particular that is afraid of diplomacy, I think, will signal exactly that. And one thing that we tend to forget is that an ability of a superpower to remain a superpower and enjoy the legitimacy of having a critical mass of countries in the international security accepting and wanting it to lead is not based on its ability to wage war, but it's based on its ability to create peace. And that means you have to make diplomacy a very central part of your foreign policy. So what I'm trying to say in a long way to your question is, if we don't have the political landscape based on the ordinary citizens making it very clear to their members of Congress or to their president that they don't want war and they want peace, you will not see the type of necessary, patient, persistent, sustainable diplomacy take place. The only reason Obama could do this in the first place was precisely because of the political landscape that had been created, of which he played a very small role in it until he started to riding the wave. Part of the reason why he's going back to it right now, in my estimation, is partly because he's hiding behind the generals. The military is coming out very strongly in favor of diplomacy because they don't want a war. And secondly, because there has been a reaction by the populace as a result of all of the different stories about the imminence of war, in which people once again have started to make themselves very vocal in their opposition. And that is exactly the kind of things that creates the political space for the administration to pursue diplomacy. What you should watch out for, once talks begin in April of this year in Istanbul, between the P5 plus one and Iran again, is if they manage to put into place a process, not a meeting. There's been plenty of meetings in which both sides come there, one-off meetings, they exchange ultimatums, and they go back. What is needed now is a process in which they keep on meeting. The media will get so bored by the process, they will stop covering it. And that can only take place if there is that political landscape that permits the presidents to do so. And that's on you.
Could you talk a little bit more about the congressional attempts to derail, in my view, or impose their own vision on what diplomacy should be, both in 2010 and currently? And what is the political force just that the senators and congressmen want to show that they're smarter than Obama and can do it better? Or is there like an alternative political vision that they're trying to enforce through it? Thank you.
There's no competition about being smart in DC. You have a competition about who is most hawkish, but smart doesn't even make it into the competition. You have right now several pieces of legislation. You have legislation that actually explicitly forbids any interaction between the United States and Iran. You have legislation that is saying that it's unacceptable to contain a nuclear capability in Iran, which is again a different way of saying that the red line should be nuclear capability. And but you also have legislation and letters. Barbara Lee has a legislation, I think it's called the Iran Diplomacy Act. There's efforts by Congressman Ellison and Jones also to create that type of a momentum and support for diplomacy as existed in 2008, before Obama came into office. So a lot of those things are happening. But what is so sad is that even though the U.S. political system is one in which there's a tremendous amount of popular participation, its disconnect from the larger American viewpoints in the public is quite significant, particularly on this issue. When you take a look at the polls, even some of the polls that you refer to, they nevertheless do not show support for the type of policies that Congress currently is showing. But that's because it's opinions that people are holding. It's not opinions that people are expressing to Congress. That's the big difference.
Hi. In your last book, Treacherous Alliances, you spent a good deal of time talking about the changing relationship between Israel and Iran and described how, for much of the history, including after the Iranian Revolution, the two countries were public enemies but privately cooperated. So I wondered, with that in mind, if you could say something about what's behind the Israeli threats to attack Iran. Are they intended mainly for domestic consumption in both the United States and Iran, or are they serious? I think that's it. Thanks.
Again, a very good question. What is the purpose of these attacks? I think they're serious, but I wouldn't be of the opinion that they're serious in the sense that there has been a significant risk for the Israelis to take action on their own up until now. I would say that. And still, I wouldn't put it at higher than 20%. And the reason I would put it at as high as 20% right now is because of the political factors, in the sense that the political cause for the Netanyahu government to do something like this that the U.S. military is so opposed to is at its minimum in the middle of an American election year, particularly when you have Republican candidates that essentially have positioned themselves to the right of Netanyahu. The other political factor, again, is when Netanyahu becomes convinced that Obama is likely going to be a second-term president, a two-term president. At that point, I would say you would probably see another spike in the risk of military action, because if he desires to do so, it's better to do it now than to wait for the second term of the president. But nevertheless, it would be primarily driven not by anything particular happening in Iran, but because of the political factors over here. Now, why have the Israelis then made a big case about this? I think the utility of the threats have been threefold. First, to convince the United States to take military action of its own, and that's failed. Second, to convince the United States to impose maximum crippling sanctions on the Iranian. That has succeeded. And third, at a minimum, make sure that the United States does not strike a compromise with the Iranians that would permit the Iranians to retain some level of nuclear capability. And that, too, seems to be failing. Of course, we haven't, the negotiation, second round of negotiations haven't begun yet. But the administration essentially kind of signaled that that is not its objective with the negotiations.
Good evening. It's great to hear you in person. I've been attending forums on Iran and the Mideast since way back in 1990 at the Smithsonian down in DC. Before that, I lived in China. I think part of our problem is we have gone down a long way down a road, and it's hard to get the train to back up and take a different direction. I agree with a great deal of what you say. I don't think Iran is irrational. I think even if they got a couple of nuclear weapons, the likelihood that they would ever use them in a preemptive strike against one of their neighbors is preposterous. I think they would get them because those elements in Iran would see them as needed to defend themselves against all these threats. Like you said, who invades a country that already has a nuclear weapon? So therefore, I have a different, entirely different idea. What if we were to adopt the policy of going down the road of normalizing relations with Iran, much like we did, much like Nixon did with China? We would lift sanctions and allow them to build the IPI gas pipeline, the peace pipeline, from Iran's rich gas fields to Pakistan and India. Pakistan and India, deadly enemies, would now be working together with Iran in a common project from which they all benefit. It seems to me, from listening to all of this for more than 20 years, that that's the way to take the pressure cooker off the fire. And the problem with this is those that seem that the red line for them is actually shaking hands with your deadly enemy, that they would never do that. And to me, the biggest fear is that we would end up in a war with Iran based on some kind of Gulf of Tonkin incident like in Vietnam. To me, that's much more scary than Iran with a nuclear weapon. I wish you could comment on that out-of-the-box idea. Thank you.
Thank you. It is a great idea. It's out-of-box, as you said. And part of the problem is that the mistrust between the two sides is so great that any process that would be quick would most likely fail precisely because of the suspicions that exist. I think it's one thing to try to quickly shoot towards that type of end state of a normalization. It's a different thing to make clear that the end state, essentially starting the negotiations from the end, saying, this is the end state that we would like to reach. And hopefully there's a certain level of acceptance between the two sides of what a desirable end state is. And then work backwards and say, what do we need to do to reach this point? The approach that has been taken so far has been the opposite, which is we have a very fuzzy and undefined end state. We don't want to give that up because we think that would be a major concession if we declared what our end state is. Instead, we're trying to take small confidence building measures in the beginning in the hope that we could reach that end state. And as that confidence building effort is successful, more and more of the end state would be revealed. But when the mistrust is so great, there's no convincing of the other side to take the first step if they don't know what the first step is leading to. And this is part of the reason I think actually what Netanyahu managed to do was actually helpful. He managed to get the administration to reveal what its end state is, something that the administration had kept ambiguous for various reasons. One was because they feared that if they declare it too soon, that would be a major concession. This is something they rather give halfway through the negotiation than before the negotiation. Secondly, the minute they revealed that their end state was an acceptance of certain level of enrichment in Iran, they would have a major fight with Israel, with Saudi Arabia, and probably with UK and France as well. So they try to postpone that. They essentially try to keep this very central point as ambiguous as possible for as long as possible. And that fueled, instead of actually making things easier, it fueled fears on all sides. It fueled the fear on the Israeli side that the ambiguity is there to veil the fact that the US actually would accept enrichment. And it fueled the fear on the Iranian side that the ambiguity was there to conceal the fact that the US would not accept enrichment at the end of the day. By pushing this to a climax in the manner that Netanyahu did and forcing Obama to come out and declare what his red line is, I think actually that may end up being helpful. Because now it's clearer of what we're working towards. And that may, if it is mutually acceptable, may actually muster the type of a confidence and trust that is needed for both sides to dare to take that first and second step.
Thank you.
Thank you.
My question is, why does the United States want to talk to Iran only about nuclear issues instead of about broader issues? There was an op-ed on by Lewis and Pickering on Saturday. Did you see it? And one of the points they make, the P5 plus one should propose a separate forum in which interested nations can discuss directly with Iran the broader issues in the region. It would begin cooperation in areas of mutual importance, Afghanistan, Iraq, security in the Gulf, Syria, and drugs, while increasing trust reserves that can be tapped in nuclear discussions. And the Secretary General should appoint a special emissary and so on. My question is, when did we get into this box that we're only going to talk about nuclear issues first, and why is it to the United States' advantage to do that, or the administration's advantage?
I think that's an excellent question. In fact, I spend a lot of time with the administration asking exactly these questions. Because in any negotiation, you are better off if you have a few variables that you can play with. What happened in 2009, the administration said from the outset, this is a confidence-building measure. Well, if it's a confidence-building measure and you're in a negotiation and the confidence-building measure doesn't work, you try another one. But what happened is that because of the lack of political space, the confidence-building measure became a precondition for talks on any other issue. Unless the fuel swap was accepted, we would not talk to the Iranians about anything else, whether it was Persian Gulf security, Afghanistan, Iraq, human rights, nothing. And in retrospect, several administration officials have privately expressed regret and said that that was probably one of the things we should have done differently. We should have had a parallel conversation about Afghanistan in particular, because that is probably the easiest issue, the one issue in which there is most common interest between the two sides. I personally believe that they should have also had a conversation from the outset about human rights, about other issues, in order to make sure that the results of the negotiations would not be according to the old formula of the United States in the region, in which it makes a deal with the local dictator, strikes a security arrangement, but then completely sets aside the human rights abuses taking place in those countries. And a lot of people in the Green Movement, who on the one hand were happy that Obama did not come out and put on a green bandana and support them, because that's not the type of support they needed, were nevertheless very perplexed and frankly frustrated that Obama was so late in coming out and condemning the human rights abuses that were taking place there, and that he did so infrequently. It fueled their fears that perhaps he's so eager to get a nuclear deal that he's willing to sacrifice the human rights and the pro-democracy aspirations of the Iranian people. Coming to future negotiations, I think it would be instrumental to make sure that there are several different paths and channels at the same time. If one channel, the nuclear channel, gets into a problem, gets stuck, then perhaps progress in a different channel can muster the goodwill in order to redouble the political will and effort to overcome the problem in the first channel. We didn't have such a second channel, by choice. By choice, we did not have it. And as a result, once we got stuck on the fuel swap, there was nothing that anyone could do.
Hi. I was just wondering if you think that this, week or so marks a possible opportunity for recalibrating, resetting the whole problem, because this week they have an election, a parliamentary election in Iran, and also within the last week or two, the Japanese government has changed its stance on the use of nuclear power. The Germans are in the process of rejecting nuclear power, and the Hamas group has distance itself significantly from the Assad Syrian regime, which is allied with Iran. Is it, I think that's correct. So I wondered whether you would comment on, you know, I mean, it might be a good time to reach out to Iran, you know, because it's possible that a other faction other than the Ahmadinejad faction might come to power, a more moderate faction. It's possible. Also, it seems to me that when the negotiations have been going on, we've been saying everything is on the table. What we really mean is all sanctions, you know, all negative sanctions are on the table. I've yet to hear of any positive, you know, positive measures that are on the table, like, for example, pushing Israel to accept the 2002 Saudi plan, to accept the Palestinian state and to accept territorial swaps.
Thank you. On the last part of your question about positive measures, I think one of the things that Netanyahu did succeed with his trip was that so little of that trip, so little of their conversations were focused on the Israeli-Palestinian issue. It's been completely set aside. It's been completely overtaken and overshadowed by the Iran issue. And that, at a minimum, was a success for him, because the last thing he wanted to do was to have another conversation about settlements in East Jerusalem and things of that nature. As to your earlier parts of your question, sorry, if you could remind me.
The earlier part?
Oh, the new political space.
Yeah.
I don't think the administration is going to try to play that game of hoping that a different faction in Iran would be better. Just to remind us.
It would be more than hope. It would be reaching out, you know.
Well, the outreach is being done right now. And the preparations for talks are taking place right now. But I think the administration is staying away from trying to play factions against factions. In fact, the Ahmadinejad faction was the one that was most in favor of the fuel swap, believe it or not. So there's a lot of these different things that may not really translate well to our political scale and say, okay, this is the hawkish end and this is the dovish end. The thing that I think is valuable of what you pointed out, though, is that there's so many different moving parts in the region right now, so many different things that are changing as a result of the Arab uprisings, as a result of what is happening in Syria and Assad, as a result of Hamas now distancing itself from the Syrians and moving closer to some of the Sunni Arab states. Under those circumstances, yes, opportunities do arise, and the administration is probably going to try to take advantage of them. It's important, however, at the same time, to remind ourselves that there are two other things that happen under those circumstances. A, you can overestimate how much of a problem the other side thinks that it is in, and as a result, take too harsh of a position in a negotiation, essentially assuming that they're in a much weaker position than they are in. And I think there's a tendency on our end to do that. The other thing is, if there would be a military confrontation, when you have this many moving parts, it's all the more difficult to predict what the repercussions of a military confrontation would be.
One more question.
Thank you, sir. Several things. Mr. Obama did not create the expectation of success at the time when he accepted the Nobel Prize, that it would happen in his lifetime. That's one thing. The next is nuclear disarmament has been in progress very slowly over a process since the first test ban treaty in 1963. And recently, for example, the North Koreans announced that they again agreed to not test this year. In the past, that agreement has been reinforced by Mr. Clinton, for example, giving them an amount of gas, oil and gas, direct part of a bargain. This administration has been characterized by two people working in diplomatic international public law, George Mitchell and Dennis Ross, who in the Middle East found the process not successful and resigned. There may be intrinsic distrust upon the newness or the unusualness of the Obama administration. I encourage all people to think of the continuity of the objectives of the Canberra Commission. For example, this item where... Yes, sir, this is about fissile material control. Why is negotiation not first at the UN in harmony with the Conference on Disarmament and Department of Disarmament Affairs exclusively. Diplomacy is public service, not a topic.
Thank you. Once the FAR was put in the Security Council, it's under the control of the P5. And one of the things that they do not want to give up is control over the file. So even bringing it back to the IEA or to any other agency is quite unlikely. And I think it's also part of the problem because the P5 structure is right now rather crippled when it comes to dealing with Iran. You said something earlier on in your question I think is quite valuable. You pointed out that Obama did not create an expectation for success. That's a different way of saying he did not fight for political space. I think if there's one thing that he deserves criticism for, and this is not Iran specific, this is characteristic of his presidency as a whole. This is not a president that goes out there and actively tries to create political space for the issue and for the goal that he wants to achieve. Rather, he tries to adapt to the existing political landscape and weasel through and make sure that he succeeds without breaking too many eggs. Compare that to the Bush administration. President Bush gave 16 major speeches between January 2002 and March 2003, spelling out the strategic rationale for invading Iraq. Flawed rationale, in my opinion, but nevertheless, he wanted his war, and he knew that he wouldn't get it unless he sold it. Another 11 major interviews with key media in the United States by him and Dick Cheney tried to convince the American public that we needed to invade Iraq. At one point, they were so successful that, according to CNN, 79% of the American public thought Saddam Hussein was behind 9/11. Compare that to President Obama. Obama made several passionate speeches explaining the strategic rationale for diplomacy with Iran when he was candidate Obama. Once he became President Obama, it was a completely different game that was being played. In fact, I could only count one instance prior to what just happened last couple of weeks at AIPAC, in which he again made the case for why we need to talk. And that was actually during a press conference with Netanyahu in May 2009. But absent that, his strategy has been to adjust to the political landscape. Whatever the landscape is, he tries to play with it without trying to change it. And I don't think you can succeed in undoing a 30-year-old enmity with a strategy that adapts to the political landscape that created that enmity and that has perpetuated it for three decades. You can only do so by being willing, as you said, go out there and make an expectation for success, argue, and try to get the American people to your side in a sustained way rather than just adjusting to that landscape.
And the Comprehensive Test Ban Treaty Organization and the International Monitoring and Verification Agency, as it progressively annexed in the countries which did not have the protocol yet approved. I believe those are both means of, at the UN of existing forum. And also there is the matter of agreement when there is a current status, for example, as you mentioned earlier with Mr. Talajani, even in the last 2 weeks there has been progressive negotiation success. That is then the current status of the affair, and there is not to be a recidivism. How do you think we should manage that better?
Again, I don't know if I quite understood the question, but bottom line is, this is now in the P5. The P5 is above all other these things. This doesn't go into disarmament because Iran doesn't have nuclear weapons in order to disarm them. This is at the non-proliferation stage right now. And nevertheless, it's all political at this stage because once it is at the Security Council, it will not leave the Security Council unless the P5 agree to let go of the issue, and that's just simply not going to happen. So trying to create additional avenues within the UN system to discuss this, I don't think is going to be successful.
We need to wrap up in just a moment. I wanted to ask you one question. There is a lot of blame, as you've said a few times, for the media. I understand that. But as a journalist who has been desperate to get back to Iran to tell their side of the story, there is some fault with the government because they don't let Western journalists in very often. But I do wonder what Iranians feel. You know, we see the debate here, and sort of the drums of war. But you began by saying that the leaders in Iran do, to some extent, listen to the feelings of the people there. What are the feelings of the people there? I went there in 2004, and people said, look, we're a nation like any other nation. We deserve nuclear power. We deserve the ability to, the knowledge like anyone else. There was debate on whether they should or shouldn't have weapons. You know, now, 8 years later, what do they think?
First, I think you're absolutely right on your first point. The Iranian government hardly gives out any visas to Western journalists, making it very difficult for people to go there. They gave, I think, 12 visas just last week for people to cover the elections, and they covered the elections from buses. They weren't really given the freedom to, at least not on election day, to go to various polling stations. They had to abide with what the government permitted them to access. And that is making things much more difficult, absolutely. The flaw with the media, in my sense, though, is not necessarily a lack of access, although that is a big problem. The flaw is not asking the right questions at the right time. Not to accept allegations as facts. It's amazing to see how accusations get a stickiness when journalists include them in their questions in an uncritical way. That's what happened with the Iraq war, and I fear that there is some elements in the media that is repeating it, particularly this frame that has been perpetuated, that we essentially have to choose between bombing Iran and accepting Iranian bomb. It is utterly false. And you see the president himself is trying to dispel that frame. On to the larger question of what did the Iranian people want. I think they want probably what everyone else wants in this world. They're tired of the repression that they're living under. They're tired of the human rights abuses and the lacks of freedom that they're having. They're tired of being stuck in an enmity with a country who they deeply admire, whose culture they appreciate, and whose people they have warm feelings about, the United States of America. They are tired of being disconnected from the rest of the world and having their own government increasingly sanction their access to internet, filter the way of being able to get information from the outside, while the US also is imposing sanctions that are also affecting the flow of information. And they're feeling quite squeezed in between. I'm hearing a lot of anger amongst the Iranian population about the latest wave of sanctions that are putting a tremendous amount of pressure on the Iranian people, while they think they know that the West knows that the population, by and large, is not happy with the government of Iran. So why are the people being punished? Why are they being squeezed in the middle? Now, when it comes to the final issue, so would they want nuclear energy or nuclear power or nuclear weapons? I never came across any majority of people in Iran, nor have I seen any polls that would indicate that there is support for nuclear weapons amongst the population. On the contrary, support for having access to nuclear technology, however, seems to be quite widespread. And it's been reflected by both polls and other things. But we also have to remember that for the last couple of years, it has been forbidden to debate this issue in the Iranian media. That makes it even more difficult for us to be able to try to understand what is it that the Iranian population actually wants or doesn't want. But I would still tend to err on the side of saying that it is extremely difficult for them to accept that there should be an exemption made for them in which other countries have an entitlement to this energy, to this technology, while they shouldn't. We have to remember, this is a country that is tremendously proud of its nuclear achievement, of its scientific achievements, which are not few, incidentally. They're one of the countries in the world that produce more academic articles in journals on both both on brain surgery and neuroscience, but also on this other thing that is so, sorry? Nanotechnology, but also lots of good stuff. Okay, it's one out of 9 countries in the world that could put a satellite in space.
They're wicked smart, to use local parlance.
Apparently, they managed to bring down that American drone. Which increasingly has become clear that they actually did manage to do so. It's quite a lot of achievements, and they take great pride in that. So limiting on that, I think, is going to be very difficult to see that they would buy into. But at the same time, the real proposition has never been put in front of them, in which they would be offered complete lifting of sanctions, being brought back into the world community, decontainment, and as a result, would you be willing to suspend or willing to give up this up for a while? That offer has never really been made. Most of the offers that are being made, until this day, I think they remain true. We have quite concrete requests of what they need to give up right away, and then quite fuzzy promises of what we will give them at some point later down the road. And they're simply not convincing, even for a public that otherwise really dislikes its own government. Thank you.
Trita Parsi, thank you so much. You have been listening to a program of Cambridge Forum recorded in March 2012, co-sponsored by the First Parish in Cambridge, the Lowell Institute, and the Friends of Cambridge Forum. For more information about this radio program entitled Obama and Iran, A Single Roll of the Dice, featuring Trita Parsi, or about our ongoing radio series and our WGBH Forum Network webcasts, visit us on the web at www.cambridgeforum.org. In Harvard Square, I'm Aaron Schachter, and thank you so much for joining us.